Continues on page 1 with the processional hymn, The Church is One Foundation.
Thank you. and blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Please pray with us. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The first lesson is from the book of Exodus. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, "Look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land." Therefore they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramses for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service, in mortar and brick, and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Shiphrah and the other Puah, "When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him, but if it is a girl, she shall live." But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this and allowed the boys to live?" The midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them." So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, "Every boy that is born to the Hebrews you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live." Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying, and she took pity on him. "This must be one of the Hebrews' children," she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, "Shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew women to nurse the child for you?" Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Yes." So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, "Take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages." So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses, because she said, "I drew him out of the water." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for today is read responsibly by half verse. If the Lord had not been on our side,
let Israel now say.
If the Lord had not been on our side,
when enemies rose up against us,
then would they have swallowed us up alive
in their fierce anger toward us.
Then would the waters have overwhelmed us,
and the torrent gone over us.
Then will the raging waters
have gone right over us.
Blessed be the Lord.
He has not given us over to be a prey for their teeth.
We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler.
The snare is broken, and we have escaped.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
the Maker of heaven and earth.
The second lesson is taken from the book of Romans. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Last week, we started with the Old Testament, where we find that Jesus relied heavily on the Hebrew scriptures to inform his teaching, to help his listeners and followers to understand his mission, to understand God's actions in their lives. Today, we focus on Jesus and the Gospels. In these turbulent times, we need Jesus. We need Jesus to help us deal with the effect of this pandemic in our lives. We need Jesus. The coronavirus has forever altered our lives, our health systems, our economic systems, and our educational systems are permanently changed. Our ability to connect and support one another in our family and religious structures are different. In this section of the book, N.T. Wright tells us that the word now is significant in the New Testament. He uses the common expression that was then, this is now, to transition from the plight to the solution. The plight to the solution. Truthfully, we are all probably feeling like we are stuck. Stuck without a clear direction of how to escape from these challenging days. But let's dig further. Wright differentiates between looking forward and looking back. The what to do we do now versus how did we get here? Why are we living in what seems like an endless nightmare? To looking forward. What is God going to do about these times? And what are we going to do about these times? Wright explains, Jesus could on occasion point to disasters that had happened and warn his listeners that unless they repented, they would be next. For instance, we find this in Luke chapter 13, verses 1 through 9. Yet, that was a very specific situation. In this instance, the Roman governor had sent in the troops and killed pilgrims in the temple. And then a nearby tower had collapsed and crushed 18 people to death. The question becomes, these people who died, were they worse sinners than all the others in Jerusalem? Jesus says no. But Jesus warns, unless you repent, you will all be destroyed in the same way. And so clearly, there was a sense of urgency to Jesus' call for God's people to repent and for God's people to turn from their destructive behaviors. Here, Jesus is saying that neither the Galileans nor those working in the tower next door should be blamed for their misfortune. Instead, everyone should pay attention to their own judgment day. This was a particular moment, says N.T. Wright. The decisive moment, in fact, for the history on ancient Israel, on the Jewish people and institutions of the time. The warnings were all about the imminent destruction of Jerusalem. You know that Jerusalem was the center of power. And yet, for Jesus, unless the people change their ways radically, then Roman swords and falling stonework would finish most of them off. Jesus could read the signs of the times, even if most of the people of his time could not. So far, so prophetic. 40 years later, Jesus was proved right. The Jerusalem temple was destroyed 40 years after Jesus' prediction. Yes, there is a sense of urgency to Jesus' call that we repent and turn to God. N.T. Wright says, yet Jesus went further. When people ask him for a sign from heaven, He saw their request as a sign of unbelief. They wanted things to be obvious. The only sign he would give them, he said, was another prophetic sign, the sign of Jonah, as found in Matthew chapter 12, verse 39. Here, you'll recall that Jonah disappeared into the belly of the whale and then came out alive 3 days later. That, said Jesus, was the sign that would tell his generation what was going on. We must not ignore the signs of the times. In the Gospel of John, we find a list of Jesus' signs. Jesus' signs were all about new creation, changing water into wine, healing, feeding the hungry, giving sight to the blind. The other Gospels include several more signs, like Jesus enjoying a good party with all the wrong kind of people, suggesting a future full of forgiveness. We serve God in Jesus who forgives. For N.T. Wright, he believes that Jesus seems to have been standing at the threshold. Sometimes he could speak and act like an Old Testament prophet. And people did say that Jesus reminded them of Jeremiah or Elijah. Which gives you rather a different picture to the standard image of Jesus is meek and mild. Yet at other times, Jesus seems to have been looking not backward to sins which might bring judgment, but forward to the new kingdom of God. That is certainly the picture we get from reading the 9th chapter of John's Gospel. Here, Jesus and his disciples come upon a man who had been blind from birth. His disciples ask the standard question, not that different from the question many people are asking today about the coronavirus. Teacher, whose sin was it that caused this man to be born blind? Did he sin or did his parents? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. Here, instead of focusing on the past, Jesus looks forward to see what God is going to do about the man's situation in the here and now through Jesus himself. After all, Jesus is the light of the world. So Jesus heals the man. Jesus is the now time. This is Jesus' time. And we must keep faith. We must glorify God. Of course, Jesus himself is the ultimate sign. The Gospels present Jesus as standing at a moment of great transition. Turn now, Jesus says. Follow God's way of peace rather than your crazy flight into national rebellion against Rome. If you don't, it will mean disaster. This becomes perhaps most explicit in Luke chapter 19. As Jesus rides into Jerusalem on a donkey, in tears, lamenting the destruction that will come on the city because the people had indeed refused his way of peace. My brothers and sisters, we live in a world today that needs to embrace Jesus' way of peace. We as a church must read the signs of the times and act while we have time. Why did God send Jesus into the world? God sent Jesus into the world not to condemn the world, but to save the world. Because God loves you so. Because God loves me so. Because God loves the world so. And God is determined to redeem God's creation. Throughout his ministry, Jesus keeps pointing forward to a new world. In this new world, Jesus himself will be the one true sign, directing the worldwide call to repent. When he does talk of wars, famines, earthquakes, and the like, he doesn't say, so when these things happen, you must think carefully about what you and your society should be repenting of. But he says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 6, don't be disturbed. The end is not yet. Instead, put your trust in me. My sisters and brothers, here in the year 2020, we are dealing with the coronavirus pandemic, record-breaking heat, melting ice caps, raging wildfires, a grim hurricane forecast, and a crisis of systemic racism and inequality prevalent in our society. Jesus says, put your trust in me. Discern the signs of the times and the will of God. In today's gospel lesson, we find an important moment in Jesus' ministry. This is an important moment for the church. Jesus said to his disciples, who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. Amen. What is the rock that Jesus will build his church on? Jesus said, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. The word it refers to the church. Jesus is saying to the disciples that the church is fighting against the empire of Rome. Such an empire cares very little about the sanctity of life. The church is fighting against the powers and principalities of this world. The church is the defense against the evil empires of this world. The church is the defense against those who mistreat and abuse and oppress God's children. What are the keys of the kingdom of God? It is not some mythical demagogue sitting on a throne at the pearly gate of heaven, deciding who gets in and who does not. No, the keys of the kingdom of God are found in the hardcore ministries of Jesus of Nazareth. We have been talking about the ministries over the past few Sundays. Jesus feeds the poor. Jesus heals the sick. Jesus welcomes the strangers and those whom society considers less than. My brothers and sisters, our best defense in these times is to embody the ministry of Jesus in the world. It is to do what Jesus did. It is in Jesus' ministry that the world will find hope. What is the hope that we have to offer to the world in this time of pandemic? It is to renew our commitment to care for the poor, the sick, and the oppressed. To support our brothers and sisters in Christ, our essential workers, our educators, and our parents. Jesus was the ultimate servant king. Amen?
Amen.
N.T. Wright says, a lot of the talk about what God is doing in the coronavirus pandemic assumes that God is sovereign. And it assumes what that sovereignty will mean. Jesus, though, was unveiling a different meaning of divine sovereignty. Sovereignty is based upon a servant style of leadership. Jesus gathered and partied with all the wrong people. Jesus went to Jerusalem that last time and solemnly announced God's final judgment on the city, the system, and the institution, the temple that had refused God's way of peace. Jesus broke bread on the last night with his friends. Jesus hung on the cross with the words, King of the Jews, above his head. What might sovereignty look like in our world of pandemic today? What criteria are we using to discern God's will, God's presence, or God's absence in the pandemic? Faith tells us that God is at work in the world, even amid the coronavirus pandemic. The kingdom of God is a divine reality through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of God is the reality of God's presence with us and among us. My sisters, my brothers, as we prepare to break bread together, just as Jesus would have gathered his disciples, let us remember the words of the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, right here, right now, on earth. Let us bring God's kingdom into the world. Let the church say it.
Amen.
Amen. Please turn to the top of page 5 of your service booklet and let us sing On Christ the Solid Rock. Thank you. the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and his Son. With the Father and his Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are Form 3, found on page 5 of your service booklet. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church,
that we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you,
that your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons,
that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world,
that there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake,
that our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble,
that they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Pray for the continual recovery of my brother Boris and my granddaughter Antoinette as they fight the good fight towards their recovery.
For the sick and shut-ins listed in our bulletin, for those preparing to have surgery, we pray for those celebrating a birthday or anniversary this week. May the Lord bless you and keep you this day and all the rest of your life. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
My sisters, my brothers, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you for your presence with us on this, our 12th Sunday after Pentecost. I want to thank you for your continued support of our ministry here at St. John's. In the service bulletin, we have provided you with information for how you can send your financial offerings and donations to St. John's. If you are able, please continue to support our ministry as we strive to build God's kingdom in this community and in the world. Jesus said, "A new commandment I give to you, love one another as I have loved you." And so walk in love, as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. The offertory hymn is, "O love that wilt not let me go," found on page 6 of your service booklet, Mr. Larry Walker, Cantor. We offer this Holy Communion to glorify Almighty God and in thanksgiving for God's many blessings. We also dedicate this Holy Communion in honor of Emmanuel and Ada Igbo as they celebrate their 30 years marriage anniversary. To God be the glory. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. To live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Together,
sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia! Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia!
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. My sisters, my brothers, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you in everlasting life. Amen. If you have used your own bread and wine or juice at home during the Great Thanksgiving prayer, you may use the following words before consuming the bread and wine or juice. O God, bless this bread and this wine or juice I now consume. Amen.
Holy Son, your sent to God, God you have
Together let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. My sisters, my brothers, life is short, and we don't have too much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. And so, be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
Alleluia, Alleluia.